Let us clear away the misapprehension that "do unto others as you would have them do unto you" is a novel preaching of the Nazarene. In fact, this sentiment, known as the ethic of reciprocity, can be found in historical texts that predate the Christ by a millennia. As a general rule, it isn't bad, but there are certainly exceptions. Surely we wouldn't want a sadomasochist following this preachment. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. An ordinary man who said these things would not be a moral man, but would be considered a monster. Imagine that you are violently assaulted by a pair of thugs, during which they delight in causing you misery. You would have good reason to wish justice, but justice has no meaning in a world where the thugs feel no guilt. For the thugs believe that the Christ forgives all sins. Forgiveness is a necessity for feelings of guilt to go away, but they do not need your forgiveness. They do not offer you an apology. Yeshua ben Yosef has told them that he has already forgiven them, that they are cleansed of all unrighteousness. And remember that we are assessing his teachings as if he were merely a man. A second example. Imagine if a judge were to forgive and pardon a convicted rapist for his crimes against a young girl. Even if the rapist claims to and really does regret his actions, what right would the judge have to forgive the rapist on the girl's behalf? It is the girl's place to forgive or to not, as she chooses, and it must ultimately be her decision in seeking peace of mind. Forgiveness can only be granted by those wronged, and the preaching of the Nazarene is vile in suggesting otherwise. Imagine you are a doctor, and a close friend has just stepped into your office to hear the results of their cancer screening. You read through the results, and to your dismay, you discover that they have a very aggressive and advanced tumour that will be fatal within months. Imagine that your friend has a family, a job, retirement plans, a happy life. The news will be life-shattering. You now have two choices. The first choice. You tell them the truth. They are going to die soon. They weep and despair and go into the arms of their loved ones and live the rest of their brief existence on their own terms. They can do the things that they had always wanted to do, the things a life of commitments had never let them do. They might realize, for the first time, the value and brevity of this life, and the air never tastes better. Your news is not comforting. They do not want it, but it is true. The second choice. You don't tell them the truth. You tell them what is comforting, what they want to hear. You tell them that they don't have cancer, that they are free to live a happy and full life. They celebrate and go back to their life, but it isn't true. They return to the world of work, stress, and living. But their condition deteriorates, and they feel it, only too late. They realize that you lied to them. You can only imagine their fury. You took from them the most precious time of their life, their final days of health. They did not live out their days on their terms, as they would have wanted.